Before beginning my paper, I would like to make two clarifications. Today I have decided to present a more elaborated version of a paper that I'm still working on, a paper that reflects the situation I encountered when I first arrived to Leros in the summer of 2016. Since the effects of the so-called refugee crisis continue, it's hard to discuss all the different stages and affects exuded during the last years. But as the anthropologist Jason De Leon argues about his own experience while working for years in the US-Mexico border, it's important to hold on to those thoughts and feelings emerging during the first period of doing fieldwork, because as time passes by and exposure to violence gets routinized, those moments seem to lose their edge and dissolve. Also, I would like to mention that in the summer of 2016, I had the chance to find in Leros an old friend, Yorgos Makas, who was there as a photographer, both interested in the refugee crisis and in the history of the island. My presentation today will be accompanied by his photographs, a decision that we commonly took in order to offer different layers of a story captured by other analytical lenses. In this sense, then, this presentation today reflects traces of our ongoing dialogue, but it also mirrors a dialogue between different genres that both relate and disrelate. It is an experiment in this sense. A site of one of Italy's largest naval bases in the Mediterranean Sea till the end of the Second World War, and an exile island for political dissenters during the Greek military junta of 1967-74, Leros was denounced later as the island of the outcasts, human storage, and the guilty secret of Europe because of the inhumane psychiatric treatment that many of the patients of the Leros Psychiatric Hospital received, as more than 4,000 people were gradually brought to the island since the hospital started functioning in 1958. In 2015, the decision to build a refugee hotspot camp in the area of Lepida, which is the same area where both the political exiles and the psychiatric patients were kept, once again touched upon past traumas at a time when more than 38,000 people were passing through the island, an island where the permanent inhabitants are less than 9,000. In July 2016, when I began my fieldwork, most of the refugees were stranded in Leros because of the geographical restrictions implemented after the EU-Turkey agreement and the closing down of the European borders. Under such loaded historical, social, and political circumstances, and while following traces that mark the past as present in the most uncanny ways in the everyday life of both the islanders and the refugees, this paper asks, what kind of future archives does the current refugee crisis create? By posing this question, I do not refer to the tragic images of the dead drowned in the Mediterranean Sea that circulated widely in the social media during the last years. Their constant circulation cannot be disassociated from the colonial fantasy of a white Europe that derives an uncanny pleasure from the voyeuristic intrusion into the wound of the other. Those images rely on necropolitical scenarios that colonize the suffering body and dehumanize those subjected to violence. Instead, I am interested in archiving space of refuge, archives that cannot be easily archived, and archives that are not part of official historical narratives and logocentric representations. And hence I ask, how can we understand the notion of finding refuge as this changes historically and as part of the changing shape of crisis politics? More than that, what is the relation between the materiality of space, the ghosts of war and exile, and the experience of contemporary displacement and confinement caused by the new realities of refugeeness. These questions are particularly important in the case of Leros, as it is an island significantly stigmatized by the operation of the psychiatric hospital. The current refugee crisis came to add one more layer on top of a past history that was already defined by other wars, displacements, and exiles, which continue to haunt the atmosphere of the island and the relationships formed in this space. It is for this reason why I have decided to explore this space through the notion of the palimpsest. My intention here is neither to prioritize structural violence through an implementation of historical determinism, nor to attribute false will and agency to those exposed to such structures. On the contrary, I use palimpsest as a decolonial strategy and a performative trope, enabling a rearchiving of both the past and the future in order to dematerialize and remap detrimental experiences of the present through analyzing the shifting relationships of different forces and powers. My argument then is that a palimpsestous reading of history and space help us to relate and understand processes of uprootedness and confinement, of disassociation and solidarity, and most importantly, the desire to make life sustainable while moving away from acts of philanthropy and neo-colonial ideologies still present in any encounter with suffering, trauma, and identity. Moreover, in what follows, I attempt a reading of the history and the space of Leros through the affective and performative state of being in waiting, that I have seen it defining the atmosphere of the refugee crisis upon my arrival to the island in the summer of 2016. Waiting here has a double valence. One side depicts the affective textual layers that mark the state of being a refugee as a crisis that is at the same time an anti-crisis, especially because the urgency of crisis is not only experienced when adrenaline rises, but when a pause comes to compress the experience of accelerated time, when nothing happens, or when someone gets stuck in waiting. The other side illustrates an embroidered fabric of histories of both confinement and solidarity that lie upon a palimpsestic text that needs to be constantly reworked in order to dismantle the shocking effect of dominant representations of past and present traumas. It is like prompting pause before narrative to critically ask yourself, wait, how can I really tell this injurious story without creating a new injury? Entering the field. Before arriving to Leros in mid-July 2016, I was not only conscious about how the recent failed coup in Turkey affected the situation in Leros, an island situated across the coastline of Bodrum and Didim, but I was also warned about tensions that lingered on from riots which had erupted a couple of weeks earlier. A group of minors had apparently revolted against the inhumane conditions of the hotspot camp in Lepida, which had been set up within 2 weeks in March 2016, when the EU-Turkey deal was signed, without creating the necessary infrastructure to care for more than 1,000 people. Instead of reception centers, the hotspot approach, according to Didier Fassan, aimed to identify fingerprint and classify people in order to police the thin line between irregular migrants and true refugees, acting on the assumption that such a distinction is relevant and possible. As a result of the agreement, people could not apply for asylum directly, but they were going to be judged on their eligibility to apply for asylum, a process that does not only nullify the essence of human rights laws, but leaves people waiting in a limbo state, and of course in an increasingly stressful situation regarding their present status and fate. At the same time, family reunification could take several months before being activated, if applicable at all. Relocation procedures affected mainly those in the mainland and not those in the islands, and since the 16th of June 2016, it excluded the Iraqis. Moreover, violent deportations had already started, whereby people were literally kidnapped from camps and forced back to Turkey. As refugees were left without official legal advice and detained in camps where they were exposed to harsh weather conditions and insufficient provisions of safe housing, nutrition, medical care, legal advice, and so on, and where they had to co-inhabit space with people from different national, religious, and ethnic backgrounds that might be inimical to one another, hotspots rather than places created to assess and treat humanitarian crises became placeholders of the history of violence recycled in the name of humanitarian crisis and humanitarian aid. This dark side of the refugee crisis was revealed in Leros in the summer 2016, when some supporters of the neo-Nazi political party Golden Dawn, together with some locals who found the excuse to discharge affects of fear and loathing against the refugees that were being apparently accumulated for a long time, organized a demonstration against them. They also had the support of the mayor of the island, who was polarizing the locals. Riot police arrived to the island to protect the islanders and the foreigners from the rage of those who were burning down the containers, computers, tents, and so on. Also, a group of about 150, mostly Iraqi Yazidis, decided to leave the camp at Lepida and head to the island's main port, Laki, as they felt threatened by the other refugees. Moreover, NGO members stopped working at the hotspot, and some left the island after seeing their own lives being threatened. No one could get official permits to work in the camp, and sometimes even visiting the broader area of Lepida was considered suspicious and hence informally restricted. The police unjustly arrested around 30 minors, some of which were detained in the police headquarters of Leros and were later taken to jails in Athens without following, of course, the correct legal procedures. Ultimately, this tension defined the entry into my field, a field that soon emerged as one full of inscriptions marked upon a palimpsest, which is a multi-layered record where the original text has been effaced or partially erased and then overwritten by another. This is the feeling I had while wandering around the white streets of the poor town of Laki, where nothing seemed reminiscent of the recent riots in late July 2016, apart from the existing tension in the atmosphere. Similarly, there were only few traces indicated to what had happened the previous year, when more than 38,000 refugees were passing through the island, and the newcomers had to find temporal refuge in the courtyard of buildings, regardless of the weather condition and of their own health condition. Those days, though, have marked people's lives, and the islanders keep on discussing about those days when solidarity was proven by exceeding its own limits, as I was often told. In the summer of 2016, no one was camping anymore in the yard of the Port Authority headquarters and of the empty buildings. The weather was unbearably hot, the streets were empty during daytime and crowded in the evenings, the moods were just tranquil. Everything seemed to be contained inside the hotspot in an increasingly tense but also relatively calm atmosphere of waiting. Waiting for new directives, waiting for the asylum procedures to be clarified, waiting for more employees to arrive to the reception offices and asylum officers to be appointed, waiting to see how many more people will arrive next and who will survive, waiting in the hospital for the doctors, waiting for people to appear in the streets in the evening, waiting. Being in waiting is a particular state of living on that deserves special attention, as I want to suggest. In the companion text of Borderlines, Jacques Derrida elaborates on the uncanny state of living on, which he describes, and I quote, as a reprieve or an afterlife, life after life, or life after death, more life or more than life, and better, the state of suspension in which life is over and over again, and you'll never have done with that suspension itself. This unsettling affect of waiting that alludes to a state of living on, spreading in the atmosphere that summer, might alert us to a particularly complex structure of interrelated texts, which represent what Jacques Derrida describes as the non-contemporaneity with itself of the living present. In other words, living on does not only signify a dependence on something for sustenance, but also the destabilizing temporality of a surviving memory after something or someone has been forgotten and lost, after something appears to have died. Indeed, this enigmatic surplus of the state of suspension and waiting that was exuded that day in the empty streets of Leros indicate that the erased text lives on and cannot be easily obliterated. Instead, as Roland Barthes highlights, texts and erasures are superimposed to bring about other texts and erasures. A new erasure creates text, a new text creates erasure. Unable to apply and be granted with official permission to do research at the hotspot at that time, I also found myself in a state of waiting, which provided me with enough time to work on the condensed and paradoxical texts surrounding the so-called refugee crisis of that time. There are always other words in words, other texts in texts. As Maria Jesus Martinez Alfaro argues while following Julia Kristeva and continues, I quote, "The concept of intertextuality requires, therefore, that we understand text not as self-constrained systems, but as differential and historical, as traces and tracings of otherness, since they are shaped by the repetition and transformation of other textual structures." And I will linger more on this point in what follows. Space as palimpsest. Knowing about the riots, I was initially careful about discussing openly with locals the purpose of my stay in Leros. However, after being pressured by my first hostess, I explained that I had come to help with the refugees, emphasizing that I was not working for any organization. My hostess took this in with satisfaction, as she was convinced that the recent riots were ignited by NGOs who polarized people and had turned the refugees against the locals, a view that was also shared by other Lerians who were gossiping about how the NGOs were allegedly profiting from the current situation. Although not a Lerian, my hostess had moved to the island many years ago because of her husband's job, a retired officer from the Greek naval base in Leros. She said that her husband would have had many stories to share with me, while she also had a few to narrate. I was especially drawn to the story about a young girl who had drowned in the sea. The locals had dressed her in white for the funeral and buried her in Leros. She looked like a young bride, she said, feeling moved. This information surprised me, as I knew that most of the people who came to Leros first arrived at the Pharmakonisi Islet, a military base only 6 nautical miles away from the Turkish coast. The islanders were generally, therefore, not immediately exposed to the death of refugees, as was the case in Lesbos. Later, I also heard of a story that dead babies were put in ice cream refrigerators because they would be transferred and buried in nearby islands like Rhode Island. The following day, Yorgos and I decided to visit the cemetery near Laki. At noontime, with the eerie but serene aura of a space of death surrounding us, we followed the marble path leading to a small church. On both sides, expensive marble gravestones of Lerians featured inscriptions informing us of the dead's name, age, birth, and death dates, dedications or some special words of affection by close relatives. On the right side, one would find similar graves, the only difference being the cost of marble defining the status of the dead according to lineage, profession, and acquired wealth. A few foreigners from Italy and elsewhere were also buried there. On the left side, though, a different demographic reality was staged almost theatrically. I lingered for a while over a grave that bore the inscription Mariotti Sebastiano Lavoratore Combattate Fascista. I stared at this grave while thinking that this man died exactly 10 years before the infamous Battle of Leros, when the island was subjected to heavy bombings by the German air forces. For 52 days between 26 September and 11 November 1943, Leros was turned into a battlefield that resulted in the occupation by the Germans, an occupation that lasted till the end of the Second World War in 1945. That period was followed by two-year occupation by the English and culminated in the island's reunification with Greece on March 7, 1948. However, the marks of that period were not as prominent in the island's landscape as those left by the Italians. Arriving to the port town of Lachi, one cannot fail to notice the uniqueness of its buildings and streets. Lachi, once known as Porto Lago, was named after Mario Lago, who became the governor of the Dodecanese island complex when the Lausanne Treaty of 1923 had placed them under the Italian administration. From 1923 to 1936, Lachi was magnificently transformed into the largest naval base in the Mediterranean Sea, built in a modern style that is now associated with the fascist architecture of the 30s. Nevertheless, traces of the Battle of Leros were more vivid in the memories of the inhabitants. The previous morning, I had spent hours chatting with a 91-year-old woman, Theodorino, Auntie Eirini. While making coffee, she recollected scattered memories of her youth and of the bombings. Either married or single, all would find refuge in the shelters. From dusk till dawn, the world was falling apart. I cannot even recall the amount of bombs dropping. My mother kept a big mirror in the living room. The bomb dropped, the mirror broke. I took a blanket to cover my father. My father was smoking a lot and could not stay in the shelter. He could not breathe. Look there. There are the stairs. I keep an empty bobsail. I planted a cactus inside and keep it as memory. Later, the broken mirror made me think of the uncanny connections created when the experience of war and displacement leaves on the broken pieces of memory where one also finds refuge, memories that are effectively transmitted through a painful attachment to objects that have turned to ashes. I had paid a lot of money for them. Look how beautiful they were. Manal had told me while showing me photos of her house in Aleppo, pointing out the dazzling chandelier in the living room and the expensive curtains she had chosen herself. The same evening that they left their house, it turned into a pile of rubble. Luna, which is her oldest daughter, saved us, she kept telling everybody. Manal was getting ready to leave her house the next morning, but Luna was crying and insisted on leaving the house immediately. Her mother surrendered to what she had thought was caprice, but which turned out to be the intuitive apprehension of a forthcoming disaster. The dazzling chandelier and the expensive curtains, like the broken mirror, denote a painful attachment to those lingering traces that hold a dissonant dialogue with identity, trauma, and memory. In his essay, A Note Upon the Mystic Writing Pad, Sigmund Freud explains that memory, like the mystic writing pad, provides not only a receptive surface that can be used over and over again, like a slate, but also permanent traces of what has been written. This paradoxical working of memory, defined by a simultaneous erasure and retention, violation and restoration has significantly affected the analysis of history in post-colonial writings, where it appears as the product of contestatory power relations, according to Minoli Salgado. In other words, the analysis of double time in post-colonial settings that marks both a break from the past and a particular attachment to it destabilizes dominant historical narratives because it breaks the logic of cause-effect and because it offers a critique of teleological temporality of sequential time by working to specialize history. At the same time, pushing this argument further, Sarah Dillon relies on De Quincey's use of the palimpsest to explain, and I quote, that the palimpsest of the mind occurs in an autobiographical text as a personal fantasy of resurrection. It is not a model of the mind, but a delusive imagining, a hallucination, a daydream, and continues. As with all psychological fantasies, it blurs the very boundaries between internal and external, life and death, presence and representation, by which Freud's model of the mystic writing pad remains bound. In that sense, instead of understanding the function of the palimpsest of the mind as an effect of a romantic understanding of the mirror or the doubled self, Sarah Dillon attests that the fantasy of the palimpsest of the human brain leads to a radical disjunction within the notion of identity, the self and the present, a disjunction theorized in Derrida's Spectres of Marx, for whom the spectral subject can only be the effect of iterability of a repetition that is never quite the same. If the dazzling chandelier and the expensive curtains, like the broken mirror, denote a painful attachment to those permanent woods that are not meant to be mended, one wonders here what kind of a life after life or what kind of personal fantasies of resurrection those stories enable as they merge and dissipate in time and space. Manal, who used to teach in a dentist school, was at the same time stranded in Leros together with her husband and her two daughters. She hoped to reunite with her son, who had managed to reach Germany before the EU-Turkey agreement. They were all staying in Villa Artemis, an old building outside the premises of the General Hospital of Leros in the port town of Laki. This building was renovated to become a refuge for women, children, and the ill, and has sheltered close to 8,000 refugees from its opening in April 2015 until the 19th of March 2016. At that time, it hosted 13 people. Nearby is the PICPA building that was also renovated with the enormous efforts of a few people who later formed the Leros Solidarity Network and who had received harsh criticism from the mayor and a few locals who wanted to bring all the refugees to Lepida so as to keep them removed from the life of the island. Lepida is an area stigmatized by the operation of the psychiatric hospital. Initially called Psychopath's Colony of Leros, it was established through a royal decree by the government of Konstantinos Karamanlis on 28 May 1957 and was later given the more neutral name Leros Psychiatric Hospital by the government of Georgios Papandreou in 1964. At that time, the idea was to relieve the overcrowded mental hospitals of Athens and Thessaloniki, and those chosen to embark on a boat going to Leros were mainly people forgotten by their relatives, and hence they were already socially excluded, even within the asylum. Félix Guattari, a famous philosopher and a practicing psychiatrist, visited Leros after being informed about the scandal that broke in the press in 1989 when the British Sunday newspaper The Observer published John Merritt's article entitled Europe's Guilty Secret. As François Dosset describes, and I quote, Guattari left Paris for Athens on October 8, 1989. The file of press cuttings that the journalist Eric Favereau gave him on the plane was truly staggering. Patients sat in iron cages behind barbed wire fences, 85% of the patients restrained or in straight jackets. Their treatment were described: blows, water jets to calm them down, and a waste product of about 60 or 70 deaths a year. No patient was discharged in 30 years. But Guattari concluded that what was happening in Leros was not that different from what was happening in other parts of Greece, especially at Athens at that time, and also from other parts of the world. What is truly shocking, though, is the repetition of a story that has been tremendously injurious. If a new erasure creates text and a new text creates erasure, in this case, how not to think that repetition risks ending up in a vicious circle when a new asylum is built at the heart of an old one? The Pikva building, which was erected in 1933 under the name Casa Maregina and constituted the Italian artillery barracks of Porto Lago, was transformed into a home to treat maladjusted children in 1961. At that time, it housed the Leros Child Care Center of the Pikva. Pikva here are initials, initial letters that stand for the Patriotic Foundation for Social Welfare and Care. Pikva was admitting small children, infants and those in early childhood from all over Greece with severe physical, mental, emotional and social disabilities. Theodore Rino, that I mentioned before, started working at Pikva when she was 17 years old. Like so many other Lerians who were given jobs and found financial security while being dependent on the survival of the Leros psychiatric hospital. While discussing with her about those days, she remembered, "Every afternoon I would cook and feed 240 people at Pikva. Everybody found a job either there or the psychiatric clinic. Poor souls, many died. There was no life for them. Every day I would return home feeling ill." From 1961 till 1991, Pikva admitted 914 children, out of which more than half died. Those who grew to adulthood are still housed in the building, a building that is separated into two. With the hard work and insistence of the Leros Solidarity Network, the abandoned side of the building was restored to shelter more than 100 refugees, particularly those given the status of vulnerability. The aim was to make this place feel like home for the displaced, which was a result of the work of Matina Katsiveli and her partner Spiros. Now the children of Pikva only interact with the refugee children when the latter climb over the fence, separating the yard every time they need to go and fetch their balls that escape confinement. There are random screams and other human sounds and noises coming from both sides also become reminders of a particular kind of solidarity formed between them and their neighbors, and of a shared proximity of space defined by a life living in an asylum, of living on the asylum. Indeed, the double meaning of the word asylum as the protection granted by a state to those who have left their home country seek refuge, and as an institution for the care of people who are mentally ill, reveals the paradoxical proximity shared between those whose lives have been institutionalized differently, of course, but also in similar ways. In desperate need of changing the current conditions of their lives, many refugees wish to be diagnosed as psychiatric patients in order to be given the official status of vulnerability, which would provide them with a better livelihood, if not grant them asylum. Of course, in reality, most of them already suffered from many psychological problems created by their past traumas, as well as by the state of detention, uncertainty, and limbo that they find themselves upon arrival to Europe, or when Europe becomes a failed fantasy. So here one needs to ask, following Judith Butler, what does it mean for a word not only to name, but also in some sense to perform, and in particular, to perform what it names? More concretely, what does it mean not only to acquire a name like the refugee or the mentally ill, but to perform these names? what do names do? Or else, what kind of identities do those names form, especially when the borderline separating them gets thinner and thinner as those categories start to dissipate? In the area of Lepida, the refugees are now the new neighbors of the psychiatric patients who replace the political prisoners that were brought to the island between July and September 1967 and stayed at the buildings used previously in 1949 by the Royal Technical School of Queen Federica, accommodating children whose parents were dead or they were political prisoners, partisans. According to interviews I have conducted with staff of the psychiatric hospital, many of those who were brought to the hospitals of Athens and Thessaloniki were deeply affected by the turbulent political times in Greece after the civil war, and that had severe implications in their psychic state. As I was also told, many of those stigmatized as psychiatric patients didn't even have problems which would be diagnosed today as pathological and lead to asylum treatment. Most of the people here suffered from the effects of the asylum and not from other causes, I was told by Yanis Lukas, a psychiatrist who played a crucial role in the implementation of the psychiatric reforms in Leros that started in the 90s. Indicative of those blurred identity boundaries is a widespread rumor according to which one mentally ill patient once said, "The thing that differentiates us from our neighbors," at that time their neighbors were the political exiles, "is that they only need one signature to leave this place, their own signature, whereas we need someone else to come and sign for us." In bitter irony, the fantasy of resurrection of this abjected self reflects the paradoxical tragedy of living on, that is, of striving to survive from the deadly effects of names and identities while simultaneously depending on them. Returning to the cemetery now, here special proximity was shared by the graves of the Italian fascists and the mentally ill patients. Most of the graves of the latter were poorly constructed and badly maintained. Basic information about the dead was provided. Excuse me. Surnames, either real or made up, sometimes dates of death and the inscription of the initial letters, Kappa Theta Lambda, Kratiko Therapeutirio Leru, State Infirmary of Leros, accompanied by a number marked upon a cross, placed to define the limits of the ground covered by the dead body. Those graves make associations proliferate. Images of the graves of refugees who have been circulating the social media over the past few years unavoidably come to mind. Afghan unknown and a number indicated the date of the burial become permanent traces of what has been written upon texts, upon names that have been assigned a non-status in the life after a life, and hence re-describe the haunting question of what yet needs to be rewritten as a critique of space, identity, and trauma. We had decided to visit the cemetery in order to find the grave of the young refugee girl who had died on the island. In the end, we didn't find it. However, I was later told that the parents of the young girl returned from Germany, where they are now living, to collect the bones of their child. At least her dead body didn't end up covering the soil like those bones of unclaimed and unidentified bodies that we had to cross over in order to find our way around the graves and out of the cemetery. Time lag, or being in waiting. Foucault writes, "Time appears to us as only one of the various distributive operations that are impossible for the elements that are spread out in space." July 30, 2016 was a day marked in my diary as one of the most exhausting and devastating days I had spent at PICPA as a volunteer. That day, nothing happened, and the feeling of nothingness was making life unbearable for everybody. I was doing the afternoon shift together with two more volunteers from the Leros Solidarity Network, a couple from Australia who had been living in a boat in Leros for the past few years. They, like many of those regular summer visitors, as well as those who have moved permanently to the island from different parts of the world, felt that they needed to do something about the refugees and formed a network that basically wanted to help. They wanted to help like so many others who would just drop by PICPA and volunteer for a couple of weeks. Tourists, lonely travelers, students of social sciences, people driven by philanthropy, solidarity, curiosity. Nevertheless, the encounter between the refugees and the volunteers was not unaffected by the stereotypes and the mutually projected fantasies that each carried for the other. This is especially the case because engaging with the so-called refugee crisis entails the confrontation with a double bind, with two equally dominant and problematic analytical frames. On the one hand lies the perception of refugees as either a legal category that relies heavily on accounts of war, violence, and torture, orienting attention towards the mobilization and the use of laws that should guarantee their protection, but of course, as a result, the paradox is that the existing laws fail to live up to this expectation. Or in the case that laws might actually work towards their protection, as I have tried to suggest before, it's hard to guarantee that institutionalized lives can actually have an after the asylum life. In practice, this means that even if one is granted with asylum protection, it's hard to survive later without a job, financial security, language skills, social networks, moral support, and most importantly, it's hard to survive the damaging effects of being in need of protection for too long. On the other hand, it is the perception of refugees as, and I quote, the figure of the morally legitimate suffering body, which according to Miriam Tichting makes a refugee appear, and I quote, as a victim without a perpetrator, a sufferer, pure and simple, caught in a moment of urgent need. No one is responsible for her suffering. Those who act to save her do so from the goodness of their hearts, out of moral obligation. In that sense, wars and political conflicts are temporarily erased as they are imagined to happen in a vague elsewhere that does not hold anyone accountable. The refugee crisis becomes an urgency of dealing with the situation right now, while this now encompasses the timelessness of the present. This lift of responsibility from the state, the European Union, and the international institutions results in making civil society appear responsible for helping those who suffer, re-enhancing the need to depend on charity and philanthropy, and reactivating neocolonial fantasies of helping those in need, with severe implications in the lives of those who fled their own countries. In both of these cases, the status of being a refugee dehistoricizes and depoliticizes these subjects in order to protect and help them integrate in the host country. Facing this double bind is a challenge that everybody involved in this crisis needs to face, a challenge that has been analyzed by many anthropologists who emphasize the problematic effects of this voyeuristic intrusion into the life of the other, or the side effects of hospitality, or even the need to understand crisis as a neocolonial and neoliberal technology of governance with severe political, biopolitical, and thanatopolitical implications. However, little has been written about the violent effects of inaction that risks dehumanizing people's lives and depriving them of their subjectivities. This is what started to happen after the closing down of the borders, and this is what lingered in the air that evening at PICPA. Tired of being in Leros for weeks that turned into months, most of the refugees spent enormous amount of time in their rooms, either sleeping endlessly or hanging around. At times they could come out and sit beside the front door of the building, moving from one chair to another, staring at their phones while trying to reach their relatives or gazing indifferently at the volunteers who would chase the children around the yard and in the streets. On other days, tensions would emerge when residents refused to obey the house rules of PICPA, either trying to bring food to their rooms or attempting to claim more than their fair share of water, razors, pads, shampoos, and other things, which were rare and thus had to be well distributed. But not that day. That day, there was no big drama involving children being injured while playing. There were no newcomers to ignite interest in new encounters, no broken down washing machines or refrigerators, no fights, nothing. It was just another day filled in with the same dead ends. But time was not empty. It was filled in with the emotional heaviness of waiting, the anxiety that accompanies inaction, the loss of self-worth that comes when you feel stuck, feelings that were interwoven with the stiffness of the air, the heavy humidity and sweat, the lack of fresh air. There was nothing to do, nothing to be done that day. Everything was contained inside and everything was in the air, like the history of the island, like the history of any other place that reflects a wounded locality of condensation. Those places, though, trigger a number of questions. First, the aporia of what kind of relief work can be called upon after feeling and experiencing the dead ends that make up the identity of being a refugee. But also, what kind of attunement must occur to understand how one's subjectivity affects as much as is being affected by the complexities of space and time. Because at least in this case, inaction is not opposed to action. When the body is confined and its movement has been forcefully stopped, the mind explodes, the self explodes, identity explodes. The self is also becoming then an affective palimpsest that mirrors those elements that are spread out in space. It erases traces of the past, the present, and the future, while simultaneously holding on to the past, the present, and the future, selectively, constantly, aggressively, tenderly, endlessly. One can be caught actively there, at this place, this refuge, in and out of oneself, thinking, feeling, erasing, creating, exploding. Being in waiting in this sense is a state subject to compression through the experience of accelerated time, as it is also an ambivalent state of refuge, mirroring those violent elements that are spread out in space. It is a refuge formed by, but also held in suspension, while facing the open and unresolved spectral question of what it means to keep living on a name, living on an identity, a life that strives to do more than just survive. To conclude then, my attempt to offer a layering of histories, intertextual narratives, painfully dissonant affective dispositions, along with the displaced and re-emplaced images featuring at the PowerPoint, is a gesture that aims to bring to crisis dominant politics of representation, relying on a cause-effect logic and on the urgency that our present times seem to demand. If the reading of one text is dependent on the other, if this process is never shielded but held in suspension in an open and unresolved present, then the struggle for inscription of competing discourses, images, and texts both resurrect and deconstruct the validity of crisis as an experience painfully attached only to a forgotten past or to the timelessness of the present. A lesson that still needs to be learned from post-colonial writers is that the process of dismantling both the privileges of the past and the timelessness of the present is not easy. As Gayatri Chakravorty Spivak argues in her text, Can the Subaltern Speak?, seeing colonial history through the lenses of the palimpsest is important, and I quote, not to describe the way things really were, or to privilege the narrative of history as imperialism, as the best version of history, but rather to offer an account of how an explanation and narrative of reality was established as a dominant and normative one. Hence, a rewriting of dominant narratives entails neither revealing the inner truth of how power works, nor attributing voice, will, and agency to individual pain, but disarticulating the present from its prescriptive role and hence being attentive to the shifting forces and powers that temporal compression and interability enable. As Dillon argues, it's important to understand, and I quote, the various systems of subjection that constitute history as a violent and repeated palimpsestous play of dominations and forces, substitutions, displacements, disguised conquest, and systematic reversals, all of which constitute what would constantly haunt the future archives of the present so-called refugee crisis. Thank you.